So welcome back, everyone. It is my great pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker today, Professor Joan Steitz from Yale University. Joan did her PhD at Harvard University and under supervision of James Watson, where she was working on bacteriophages and the RNA components. After PhD, she moved to MRCLNB in Cambridge for postdoctoral training, where she interacted with people like Mark Brecher, Sidney Brenner, and Francis Crick. And at that time, she actually took a project which was investigating how the bacterial mRNA is translated and how it interacts with the ribosome. Joan returned to Yale in 1970s as a faculty member, and she continued her very successful career. And among many, many important discoveries that she has made throughout the years, she's probably the most famous for discovering of the SNRPs, which are the building blocks of the spliceosome. And I have to say that Joan is really a true scientific icon. She has made, she has been not only on the top of the RNA field for so many decades, but she was always also an inspiration and a role model for several generations of scientists. And she very actively promoted gender equality in science, and this is always hugely appreciated by the entire community. Joan Steitz received countless of scientific awards and recognitions, and there's really no possibility of listing all of them. But among the most notable ones, there's a National Medal of Science and 2018 Lasker Koshland Award for Special Achievements in Medical Sciences. She's a member of National Academy since 1983, HHMI investigator, and a foreign fellow of the Royal Society. So let me just say that we are very honored and happy that you accepted our invitation to speak at this meeting, and we are very much looking forward to your talk.
Great. Okay. So thank you very much. Let me make sure, I want to make sure, that isn't what I want. How do I get rid of this pointer? There we go. Oops, I haven't gotten rid of it. Darn. Okay, so I think I don't really have a pointer because I don't know what to do unless somebody can advise me about getting rid of this little pencil.
Just try to use your shortcut again.
Okay. No, it doesn't work. I know that from experience, unfortunately, but I don't know. Clear all my drawings, clear viewers' drawings, clear all drawings. No. Well, maybe you can see the, no, now it's actually drawing. Maybe if I just get rid of this whole bar. Annotate.
You can click on clear all drawings.
Okay, let me try that again. Sorry about this. Something always happens.
Now the pointer's back, but there's still a drawing. So at the top bar, you need to clear all drawings. If you go up to the annotate bar.
Oops. Okay, annotate bar, okay. Clear all drawings, okay. Oops. Clear all drawings, okay. I still haven't gotten rid of the little pencil.
Now you need to select in that bar, there's an option where you can select the spotlight instead of the pencil.
Spotlight, yes, okay. No, the pencil's still there. Look, I can just use the pencil and hope it doesn't decide to. There we go. Oh, good. Okay, excellent. Now I can get started. Thank you for that very, very lovely introduction. And I wish everybody's having a great day. I think it's a great day for RNA in general. with the announcement this morning about Jennifer and Emanuela getting the Nobel Prize. And it's in that context that I'm very excited to tell you more about non-coding RNAs, which many of you will know we've been working on for a very long time, both non-coding RNAs from cells and from viruses. And I just want to start by saying what we're really looking for is function. And in the case of function, you would think it would be easier to find function for a viral non-coding RNA maybe than for a host non-coding RNA, because as we've seen, host non-coding RNAs can be doing absolutely anything. Whereas in the case of a viral non-coding RNA, one would think it would be either contributing to the viral life cycle or perhaps doing something to counteract the defenses that the host organism raises against the viral infection. Moreover, since viruses have limited genomes, if some of that precious space is going to be devoted to a non-coding RNA, it ought to be doing something very important. In addition, as we all know, anytime you study viruses, you always learn things about host cells. And that's very true of what I'm going to be telling you about today. So the viruses that we've been studying belong to the gamma herpes virus group of viruses. That includes KSHV, Kaposi sarcoma virus, Epstein-Barr virus, and herpes samuri virus, a less well-known virus. These viruses all have long double-stranded DNA genomes encoding about 100 functions. They have both lytic and latent phases to their viral cycles, and many are associated with human or primate cancers. For instance, I'm not going to be talking about this, but this virus, herpesvirus samuri, when it infects its natural host, it causes lytic infection, lots of viruses made. The host doesn't even seem to manifest signs of illness. But when it's put into a related, a new world monkey, such as a marmoset, it causes aggressive T cell leukemias and lymphomas. And we don't really understand the basis for that. The next slide is a sort of daunting one, but just view it as an overview, listing the non-coding RNAs we've been working on for many years, since the 1980s, and the virus they come from. This is the name of the RNA or of the RNP, the virus they come from, and how we're doing on finding functions. And what you'll notice from the early dates over here and the question marks that remain over here is that finding functions is hard. But recently there's of course been upticks because of technical advances that allow us to look for associations between RNAs and lots of other cellular components that give us clues as to where to look. And I'm not going to be talking about all of these, of course. I'm only going to be talking about one RNA today, namely the pan-RNA, the polyadenylated nuclear RNA of KSHV. And I'm not even going to be talking about its function because we don't really have that nailed down, although we know it's required for late protein synthesis and therefore for virion production. And we think at this point, but we need more work, that it has something to do with the transport of messages out of the nucleus late in infection. What I am going to be telling you about instead is how our investigations of this RNA and its structure have taken us into a whole new realm of understanding of what poly-A tails and are doing in their interactions with RNA in general. So what I'll be telling you about is RNA stabilization by a novel poly-A binding pocket and other modes of poly-A interaction with double-stranded RNA. And this is the work of Sayed Tarabi, a very dedicated postdoc in the lab, Anand Vaidya, who was in Tom Steitz's lab, my late husband, but recently then moved over to my lab, Jameen Wong and Kaju Tchaikovsky, two research scientists in the department and two fabulous technicians. And let me start out here with a little bit more background about the pan-RNA. Remember, it's a nuclear RNA. This is just a bit more about KSHV. and its association with cancer in immunocompromised individuals. These are the ugly sarcomas that it causes. The RNA was discovered in the mid-1990s in my colleague George Miller's lab and in Don Ganim's lab at UCSF. It's about a KB long, looks like any old could be messenger RNA, but we don't think it is. It's transcribed by RNA polymerase II. It's capped and polyadenylated in the usual way. Our investigations indicate that it's never exported to the cytoplasm or translated into proteins, but what's remarkable about it is that it accumulates to about 500,000 copies per cell nucleus late in infection, and therefore counts for up to 80% of the total RNA, polyadenylated RNA in the cell, and that's shown over here in this little diagram. And what's responsible for that was first discovered by Nick Conrad, who's now at UT Southwestern, when he was a postdoc in my lab. And what Nick discovered by mutagenesis of the pan RNA was that there's an element just upstream of the poly A tail, about 100 from the poly A tail, that has this U-rich internal loop in it, and that this region was responsible for this very high accumulation. And I should just have reminded everybody that, of course, there are a million SNRPs and 10 to the 7th ribosomes, so half a million is really a heck of a lot. Anyhow, so Nick found this element, and we immediately thought, well, maybe it's interacting with the poly-A tail, because we know that degradation initiates with decay of the poly-A tail and then the disappearance of the rest of the RNA, and that this might somehow protect the poly-A tail. But it wasn't until 5 years later when Rachel Mitten-Fry, postdoc in the lab, who's now at Denison University, was able to get a crystal structure of the E element along with oligo-A9. And that revealed that what's going on is that this U-rich internal loop forms this elegant triple helix. There are five triples of this sort, UAU with Watson-Crick and then Hoogsteen interactions, stacked on top of each other. And then the RNA proceeds to make A minor interactions with nucleotides in the lower stem. So I should say that this was exactly the same structure as was predicted in 1957 by Gary Felsenfeld, David Davies, and Alex Rich from fiber diffraction studies of poly-A. But this was in 1910. This was the 2010, this was the longest stretch of naturally occurring triple helix that anybody had seen. So I want to introduce at this point the assay that we use for testing stability in vivo conferred by E type elements. And that's based on beta globin, because it was discovered back in the early days of cloning that if you remove the introns from beta globin, the RNA disappears. It's not because it's not made, but it's made and very rapidly degraded. And if you insert into such a reporter construct an E in the 3' UTR, then you can get back lots of expression, as you see here, and is plotted down here. So that's what we use to ask about the ability of the elements we're studying to confer stabilization. So what I've showed you so far is that the E protects from deadenylation and decay. It can interact with oligo A. There's a five long major, what's called a major groove triple helix, and extended by minor interactions. And it's functionally important because if you mutate the string of U's, put a C in instead, the activity is abolished, but that can be restored by instead sticking one G into the poly A so that you get a CGC formed in that position. And that immediately raised the question of, do other viruses encode pan RNAs with ENEs, and are there ENE structures that protect other cellular RNAs from nuclear decay pathways? Answer to both of these is yes, and let me just very briefly tell you a little bit about those answers. Kazuo Tokowski, research scientist, set about a search for E&E-like elements, demanding that they have double strand on both sides, a certain number of U's and an internal loop, and a couple of appropriate nucleotides for an A-minor receptor, which either could be on this end or equivalently on this end. And indeed, he found, first searching the viral database, a lot of other examples in viruses closely related to, these are other herpesviruses, and then more distantly related to KSHV. This one is particularly important because this is a RNA virus that exists only for its whole life cycle in the cytoplasm. So the fact that it has an E&E was our first hint that E&Es might likewise be able to stabilize messenger RNAs in the cytoplasm and not just be active in the nucleus. Going on to look at genomic databases, what Kaju discovered was that two very well-known non-coding RNAs, well-studied, MALAT1 and MenBeta in paraspeckles, contain sequences near their three prime ends that could form E&E-like elements. Here they don't have poly-A tails, those are processed off, and instead an A-rich tract appears at the three prime end. And these could form more of these UAU triples, but they were always interrupted by what appeared to be CGC triples and perhaps additional base pair. And initially, there was a lot of biophysical evidence gathered that supported that these structures were going on, both by Jess Brown, who's a new postdoc in my lab, and by Jeremy Willits, who was in a postdoc with Phil Sharp, who's now at Penn. So what happened then was Jess Brown was determined to actually get a high resolution structure, which she did several years later at 3.1 angstroms. Here's a picture of what it looks like with its major groove, forming a major group triple helix with the A-rich tract and seeing additional base triples. One of the reasons for that interruption in the middle of the UAUs by CGC is that it seems to reset the helical axis because things get sort of out of alignment a little bit after you have five triples stacked on one another. And then by putting in something different, namely a CGC and then just a double, you can sort of reset that and get going again. And again, in our reporter assay, stabilization depended on the triple helix having A minor interactions, strong stems, and in this case, having sort of a blunt end tucked in a particular register into one end of the duplex triplex. So, of course, searches went further and Kaju then found that there were thousands of E&Es in plant and fungal genomes, and there are thousands because they're in transposable elements, and we all know that there are lots of those. He was able to identify at least two different sort of classes or kinds, all resembling the KSHV pan type rather than the MALAT1 type of sort of longer triple helix formation. And the reason that we think that they're prevalent in these particular organisms, which is plants and fungi, is that these organisms are involved in horizontal transfer. And at the same time, Hitmahani's lab at UCSF has shown that when splices in these organisms, there's a mechanism when spliceosomes become stalled on a pre-mRNA that they're trying to splice, there's a mechanism for degrading that RNA. So you might think there'd be a lot of spliceosome stalling after horizontal transfer, and that would be evolutionary pressure to get rid of introns. But I already showed you that if you get rid of introns, say in platyglobin, you have very, very rapid decay, and what compensates is an E&E, so that might be why all these E&Es are in fact in the transposable elements of these particular organisms. These ENEs, as I said, are the KSHV type, but there was one unusual sort of subclass of them that we call double ENEs or DENEs, because what they have is one ENE sort of embedded in another ENE, and they have structures that look like this, where between the two triplex forming parts is actually a stem. It can be quite imperfect, but it's always around 10 or 11 base pairs, which immediately rings a bell. The next slide just shows a lineup of a lot of these, not all of them, obviously, and shows that, again, what we're seeing is triplex stacks of usually four, sometimes five, very occasionally six UAUs. In the top ENE, in the bottom ENE, the picture is the same. And what we also noticed here, which we didn't understand for years, but I'm going to tell you later what's going on, is that there's a conserved A residue in the lower stem that's bulged out. And there are two conserved A residues in this sort of linker region just below the lower triple helix. So again, what I've told you so far is that ENEs are found in mRNAs as well as non-coding RNAs. Triple helical stacks are usually no longer than six, although the Jess Brown has recently shown in her new lab in Notre Dame that you can actually crystallize and get triple helix out of something as long as 11 UAUs. We think that they're there, and we have phylogenetic evidence in order to counteract the loss of introns and transposons, but we have more surprises. So, what we then noticed was that both this intermediary stem, about a turn of a helix, and the one at the top seemed to have a distinct pyrimidine purine bias in the strandedness. And what's more, Syed did a very ingenious experiment of where he just took that region and flipped it from strand to strand, so that it was the same sequence conferring the same stability, but flipped, and found that it lost its ability to stabilize the beta globin reporter in vivo. Likewise, if he changed all the U's to U's to C's and A's to G's, he would get stronger stabilization as exemplified here. But again, if he flipped it, that was absolutely gone. So at this point, in addition, he had physical evidence for those flips affecting the stability of the complex between poly A and the double E and E. So this is a gel shift experiment where with the wild type sequence, you see this amount of shifting into the complex. And then if you do the flip, you lose it. And likewise, okay, here are other controls, and likewise with the CG variant. And so you see the difference in stability over here. So at that point, I got very, very excited and said, there's gotta be something going on between poly A and that middle stem. Maybe there are interactions of the poly A that we just don't know anything about. We've got to get a crystal structure. And so, let's see, okay. Something funny, okay, there we go. So Syed went out and first tested to make sure that the length of poly A he was using was right. And here you see a titration of lengths of poly A, and you get a very uniform band up until about A28. So that was what he chose for his crystallization trials. Beyond that, you get some fuzziness indicating heterogeneity. And he went about trying all sorts of conditions, all sorts of constructs, something like 20,000 different conditions and constructs were tested over the next couple of years. Some of these resulted in crystals. They went to the beamline, something like 10,000 different crystals were actually shot in the beamline. But none of them gave resolution higher than about 7 or 8 angstroms until just about a year ago, he came up with these particular crystals. And this is from a rice transposable element, DNA element. And this is what the crystals looked like. And of course, after that, with the superb crystallography we have at Yale, it didn't take long to actually get the structure. So this is the take-home lesson of the whole lecture, but I will tell you more about what's going on. First, the construct that was used had the 5' and 3' ends at the other end relative to the native double E and E from the rice transposon. But the green is what's the same. And if you put this versus that into the in vivo beta globin reporter, you see it stabilizes very well. And likewise, if you do the in vitro gel shift assay, you see that you get the same sort of shift. So here's the structure from two different angles. Purple, as it will be, is the poly A. And what was immediately disappointing, at least for me, was that there are 5 adenylates right in the middle where it should be interacting with that stem that are completely missing, meaning they're disordered and not interesting. However, the structure does have various compensations in that there are various other novel modes of interaction between the double-stranded RNA regions and the poly-A, including the formation of a completely novel 3' end binding pocket that just tucks in the terminal sugar of the poly-A stretch. So let me now describe those to you. And what I'm going to do is, first of all, I want to point out that in this case, I'm going to sort of divide the structure up into the region at the top that has minor groove interactions here. Then I'm going to talk about a quintuple base transition where we're transitioning between minor groove interactions and the triple helix. The triple helix is then here, major groove triple helix. And then for the upper domain, there's a middle stem. For the lower domain, again, we have minor groove interactions, quintuple base transition, the major groove triple helix. And then here we have this wonderful 3' end binding pocket. So let me go through these serially and start talking about minor groove interactions. We've known about A minor interactions since the structure of the large subunit of the ribosome. And they've been defined, the classical ones have the minor groove of the A residue, that's this, what's called here sugar edge, sticking into the minor groove of a double helix. But other types have come up, and mostly they've been sort of said, you know, in the literature, this is weird. But what we realized is that what we actually have are interactions where it's either the Watson-Crick edge or the Hoogsteen edge of the A residue from poly A that's fitting into the minor groove. And we can categorize these, and we can also go to the literature and see that other people have seen things like this, but not taken too much notice of them, except that they were non-canonical. I'm not going to go into this very much more. I'm going to switch instead to talking about the transition, the quintuple-based transition that occurs between the minor groove interactions, both here and here, and then the major groove triples here and here. And you can see in this region that's boxed at the top is a CGAAU, and likewise CGAAU. And it's these regions that overlay perfectly on one another from the lower and the upper. So here's the C, G, A, there it is. Oops, I'm sorry. No, here's the CGA and here's the AU. Okay. So what's fun about this particular interaction is that it's there in the literature, but hasn't really been recognized. It's there in a lot of riboswitches. This is just one example. It's there in the CRISPR system. And the one I particularly love is it's there in telomerase RNA, where this is the overlay between our structure and the telomerase, almost perfect. And it's really just not been recognized as a particular motif as a way of going from A minor interactions to going to triplex. In most of the cases in the literature, the triplex is much shorter than what we're observing in our structure. So that's definitely a motif that's out there. And finally, I want to come to the 3' end binding pocket. What this slide shows is what these interactions do to the backbone of the RNA. They twist it into this Z-shaped form. And that's done by, I pointed out, this conserved A and these two conserved A's. And what happens is this A goes over and stacks between these two. You can see that right there, between A30 and A31, A56. And that gives the backbone this sort of twist a little bit more here. Here you see in a bit more detail exactly what's going on. Here's A30. A30, and A31 with A56, the base stacked in between. And this also shows how this then brings, this is the extreme 3' end of the poly A, brings it into proximity with a backbone phosphate between these residues. And here you see the stacking of those three A's on top of each other. So what does this in fact do? And I should say this we can't find in the literature. This seems to be completely novel. So what we think this does basically is block the poly A path for getting on and continuing. Here it is in three cases where the poly A continues, and here it is in space filling where it's blocked by the formation of this pocket. And that's one view. Here's another view showing the blockage. So does this actually have an effect on poly A binding, the 3' binding pocket? Yes, because if we delete these residues, those double A's and that A bulged A residue, you can in fact see in the gel shift that the affinity has between poly A and the double ENE has been reduced. So it is important. The next slide, I think, is sort of a grand finale of lots of mutagenesis. Syed has gone through and mutagenized just about everything in this structure that might have an effect. And what I want you to notice is that compared to the stabilization conferred by the wild type, the only mutations that don't seem to make a difference are the ones right in the middle of the stem in between, where the poly A is disordered and we can't see anything. Mutations in the both the upper and the lower A minor interactions, in the upper and the lower quintuple base transition, and of course in the 3' end binding pocket are deleterious with respect to stabilization. And just a word more, because I sort of forgot to say it, these Watson-Crick-Hookstein A minor interactions seem to be particularly sensitive to the purine-pyrimidine strandedness of the structure. And so this is some evidence that by mutating those, you can actually get the effects that you want to get. So I'm basically done. What have I told you? What were the unexpected things that we saw in this structure? First is that the 3' to 5' orientation of the poly A strand was opposite to what we had predicted from our previous work on triple helices. we've seen, and I hope I've convinced you, that the poly-A forms different types of A minor interactions with the biased stems. That then there's a very particular motif that's out there in the literature and quite a few examples of a quintuple-based transition between minor groove interactions in triple-stranded regions. And then we've come up with this 3' end binding pocket that, as far as at least double ENEs in plants and transposons, or transposons in plants and fungi go, has absolutely conserved nucleotides. A thing to importantly think about is that these features appear to be modular and can probably be mixed and matched in a lot of RNAs. And of course, what we're interested in at this point is, could these structures, or potential for forming these structures, be hiding in a lot of RNAs that we know and love? For instance, David Bartel's lab and Kevin Struhl's lab in mammalian and yeast messenger RNAs respectively did find that if there are secondary structures in the 3' UTRs, that those are stabilizing for the RNAs and are some of these interactions potential things that could be going on with the RNA alone. Clearly, over evolutionary time, proteins got in the act and came along, and we have poly-A binding protein, et cetera. But the question still is, do we have relics and examples where the RNA-RNA interactions that we've documented here could be important for stability and for function of lots of different RNAs? So I need to end by just thanking Syed Tarabi, who, as I said, is just amazingly persistent postdoc and also an excellent biochemist and now a crystallographer. This is Anand Vaidya, who now has a position in India, who was the crystallographic wizard along with Chamin Wong that got through the crystallography. Kajio is the one who's been out finding new structures. Rachel Mitten-Fry, who got the first triple helix structure, is now at Denison University, and Joss Brown is at Notre Dame, and Mehdi Shu, luckily, is still in the lab. So I'd like to thank you all for your attention, and I hope there'll be questions.
Thank you very much for a great talk, John. Yes, we have quite a few questions from the audience. Out from the first one is from Cosimo Yan, who's asking if there are any ENEs in mammals.
There are ENEs in MALAT1 and MenBeta, long non-coding RNAs. I mean, they're a slightly different kind. We have been searching, but it's the searching tools are based on sequence. They're not based on structure. And of course, we've been searching for them. And they're tantalizing things that are there. And we popped some of these into our reporter, stabilization reporter, to ask whether they really, do what it looks like they're doing. And so far, we haven't identified a lot. And this is something I totally don't understand, but it doesn't mean that we'll give up searching. Thank you.
Okay. Second question we have from Gregory Vulchin, he was asking, if the interaction between poly-A and ENE occurs always in cis or also in trans?
Okay, that's a good question. I think the answer is probably always in cis. And that's simply because way back, Nick Conrad did the experiment of taking in the pan-ENE, which is only a kilobase long, moving the ENE to farther and farther away from the 3' poly-A tail. And as he did so, it lost efficacy. So I think if there's competition from the same molecule, that there would certainly be interactions within that molecule, but that unless there's some sort of multi-RNA structure that holds things together, it would be difficult to form the poly-A ENE interaction out of two completely different RNAs. That's not to say it doesn't happen. It's just, I don't think it's that frequent.
Okay, thank you. And there's a question we just asked multiple times is whether you have any ideas about any proteins that could recognize this new motif.
Okay. Now, Jess Brown did a survey for proteins that recognize the MALAT1 ENE and came up with a protein that very specifically recognizes that structure and doesn't recognize the other ones. And it turned out to be a in the metal family, interestingly enough, of proteins, but an inactive, predicted to be inactive member of the metal family. We haven't recently, but of course, there are lots of good questions about, are there helicases that specifically unravel these things? Are there RNA binding proteins? I'm just excited by the RNA itself these days. Lots needs to be done.
Okay. Okay, we have a few more questions. So one question is from William Maslow, who is asking whether intronless beta globin gene mRNA is degraded in the nucleus.
Yes. It gets degraded very, very rapidly. And I'm quite sure, I mean, since the introns are necessary for it to get out to the cytoplasm, at least in that case, that these are nuclear decay pathways. And I know we've got some experts here and we just need to be working harder on what all those nuclear decay pathways are and how they variously contribute to the decay of various RNAs. Thanks, Bill.
Right, so we have another question which is asking whether DNA poly-A can affect binding of the any nuclear export machinery, but I suppose you already answered about proteins interaction.
Yeah, I mean, what we do know is that if you have a long poly-A, only a short bit of it's involved with the ENE, and you can then load on poly-A binding proteins onto the free part. That we've done those experiments and that's quite clear that can happen. So whether it would interfere or that hasn't really been asked whether actively an ENE interferes with export from the nucleus.
Right.
That's a good experiment. Thank you.
Okay. Yes, we have still a few more questions, but maybe we'll ask people to move to the Slack channel. And I would like to thank you again for this wonderful talk, and I would like to thank all other speakers in this session for contributing. And there are a few housekeeping announcements. So now we are going to have a meet the speaker sessions, and the addresses to the Zoom room meeting rooms are distributed in Slack channels, so you can all find them there. And after the meet the speaker sessions, there will be virtual poster session as well. And during that time, this main meeting room will be disabled, so you cannot stay connected here. And I will just ask everyone to come back for the next afternoon session at 5:30 p.m. to the main meeting room, and we will continue from there on with different sets of speakers. So thank you all very much again, and see you later.